It's so good to see you this morning. Beautiful Lord's Day. I want to thank Marilyn for that beautiful prelude. Hope you were listening. It was beautiful, Marilyn. And as I thank Marilyn, I want to also add Gay to our prayer list. Gay called me yesterday. She kept her grandkids this week, and she is now ill with the cold that they had. So pray for Gay, and pray the Lord will just heal her, and she'll be back next Sunday. She said she really hated to miss, but she one of her grandkids had strep throat, and so she's got it. So, got a few announcements I do want to make, but before I do that, I want to welcome those who are visiting with us. We're so glad to have you this morning. In your bulletin, you'll find a yellow slip of paper that looks like this. Take a moment, fill that out so we can have a record of your attendance. And then on the back, there's a place if you would like to share a prayer need with our church. There's a place that you can share that prayer need. And then place that in the offering plate when it's passed later this in the service. Also, if you're a member, you know of someone who is going in the hospital or you have a prayer need you want to share with the church, we'll put that on our prayer list, Wednesday night prayer list. Be sure and fill that out. We're a church that believes in prayer. Our motto this year is push. Pray until something happens. Ask God to bring a revival in our church, in our community, in our land. That's our prayer request this year. Pray for revival. In your bulletin also, there's a number of things happening. The Connections team is meeting this afternoon at 3 o'clock. Don't forget, that meeting's at 3. Next Sunday, I want to remind you, Super Sunday, we're going to have a we want to invite everybody who's on our game plan list. We want those friends of ours who might not know Christ. We're going to have an evangelistic service next Sunday morning. We like to fill this place, not have an empty chair in this place. Invite your friends to church. Some of them will come if you invite them. None of them will come if you never invite them. They won't. So invite someone to church next Sunday. We'd like to have just every place filled. And then Sunday afternoon, we have a Super Sunday party that's going to kick off next Sunday afternoon. The Ministry Center, the doors will open at 3:30. You bring your favorite football snacks, beverages to share with others. And if you don't want to watch a championship football game, that's all right. We'll have some board games and crafts and other things to enjoy. But we're just going to get together and have a good time. We're going to have a good time. So everybody be sure and put that on your calendar for next Sunday afternoon. Then I want to remind you that the Liberty Quartet will be here on the 21st, that Sunday morning. We'll have the Liberty Quartet. Now, we're going to ask you as members, we have arranged for a bus again this year. Last year when the Liberty Quartet was here, we didn't have a parking spot left in the parking lot. And we ended up parking on the street. So we're going to ask you as members, if you don't mind, that Sunday morning we'll have a bus running from Chase and Wells Fargo Bank parking lots right down here on the corner of Sunset and, Sunrise. I'm thinking something else. Sunrise and Clearwater, right down. Thank you. Boy, I don't know what I'd do without a choir who reminds me of how. I just know where it's at. I come here all the time. I don't live here. I just bees here all the time, okay? I bees here a lot. But no, I just, don't give me that look. Half of you have been where I'm at, and you can't remember your own kid's name sometime. All right, but we are going to do the most important thing we do remember, and that's God said, come into my house and worship me. We're going to worship him this morning.
Come us, will you? Oh, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh, Lord, we praise your name. Praise his name. Can't hear you. We magnify your name. Prince of Peace, mighty God, oh Lord God Almighty. Blessed Savior, we adore thee, we thy love and grace proclaim. Thou art mighty, thou art holy, glorious is thy matchless name. Glorious, glorious, glorious is thy name, O Lord, glorious, glorious. Thy name, O Lord, great Redeemer, Lord and Master, light of all eternal days, let the saints of every nation sing thy just and endless praise. Glorious, glorious.
Look at those words. Come, O come, immortal sovereign. Come and take your royal throne, whether it's in your heart or he comes again today. That's his promise. He's coming. Come, O come, immortal Savior.
Come, O come, immortal Savior. Come and take thy royal throne. Come and reign forever. Be the kingdom of thine own. Glorious is thy name, O Lord. 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 Oh, how glorious, how majestic is your name, O Lord.
Amen. Thank you so much. Let me share with you, if you have not heard, we got word this week that my kidney issue is nothing more than a fatty mass. It is fine. There is no cancer. Yeah. I cannot tell you how your praying matters. It matters. We found out today that Ernie Linthal, his brother Ron, who lived in the East Coast, passed away yesterday. We sure want to be in prayer for that family in that death. And then we want to pray for Bev Fleissen. Bev is going to have surgery Tuesday, to have knee replacement surgery. Let's bow before the Lord. What an awesome and incredible God you are, O Lord. And your name is glorious and mighty. You are the healer. You are the God of the universe. You are the ruler of heaven and earth. And we love you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that we can worship you today. Thank you that we can come in your place and that you said you'd come be here with us. Thank you, Father, for the way you work in our lives. Today, Lord, I want to ask you to come and guide this hour. I pray that our hearts would be stirred and that we would be challenged to serve you better as your people. I pray, dear God, that you would come today and minister to the needs. I pray for Ernie and his family and the death of his brother. Thank you, God, that you know how to bring comfort, that you know how to ease and help in these times. So God, be with Ernie and be with their family. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you're a God who heals. I thank you, God, that you know how to use physicians. And thank you, Lord, for the brand newest technologies. I pray for Bev as she'll have surgery. I ask you, God, to heal her quickly. Lord, there are others of our folks who are healing from knee replacements and hip replacements and many other things, dear God. I pray your healing hand upon our people. God, others in our church that are battling with cancer, oh God, set them free, heal them. God, do a mighty work in their lives. Thank you that you touch. Thank you that you heal. Thank you, God, that you move in such powerful and awesome ways. We love you, Father. God, have your way now in this service. We dedicate it and give it to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Glorious is the Lord, but he also expects obedience. If you've studied any of the children of Israel and their plight as they came out of Egypt into Israel, we know that there were several times God tested their obedience. Trust and obey. Hymn number 571.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the sky, but a smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt or a fear, not a sigh or a tear, can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil doth richly repay. Not a grief for a loss, not a frown or a cross, but it's blessed if we trust and obey. Trust
but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear of me, trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and
accomplished in all my thoughts.
you think about the lordship of Christ. Jesus is either Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. Think about that. All my longings, all my dreams, the last verse said, all my thoughts. Do you think about him? Do you think about what God wants you to do in your personal life? Something we should do daily as we walk with him. Let's stand as we sing this beautiful last stanza.
Oh, my longings and all my dreams, Jesus is Lord of all. All of my failures, his power all redeems, Jesus is Lord of all.
Sing it, King of Kings.
And Lord of lords, Jesus is Lord of all. All my possessions and all my life, Jesus is Lord of all.
Scripture reading today is taken from 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 8 through 16, and I'm reading from the King James Version. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, and that's Elijah, arise and get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand. And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but an handful of meal in a barrel, and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks, that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me therefore a little cake first, and bring it to me, and after make for thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord which he spake by Elijah. Let's pray. Lord God, we come before you this morning and we just thank you, Lord, that we have the opportunity to be here and to worship you, to give you honor and glory, and that we may just return some of the praise to you, Lord, and something for you that you have given us much, and we just thank you for that. And we pray, Lord, that we might have the faith and the courage of this widow woman. She had food enough for just she and her son, and yet she fed Elijah, and it was all based on a promise from God. God says to her, you feed them, and your meal will not waste. The barrel will not go empty until it rains again. Lord, may we have that type of courage and that type of faith, and for the promises that you've given to us. And the biggest promise of all, Lord, was your son, who you sent, Lord, that we might have eternal life through him. All we have to do is have the faith and the courage is to accept him as our personal Savior, and that as we go through life and we start reaching the latter years of our life, we may know with a great deal of certainty, Lord, and anticipation, that we may someday inherit the mansion that he's prepared for us. So just go with each one of us now, and as we take our gifts and our offerings, we just pray that you'll use them for your honor and for your glory. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church family. Now, if you know the song and you want to sing along with me, that's more than, you're more than happy with that. It's fine. Lord, let my voice be thine. Just remember in his word how he feeds the little bird. Take your burden to the Lord, leave it there. Leave it there, leave it there. I'll take your burden to the Lord, oh, and leave it there. If you trust him through your surely bring you up. Take your burden to the Lord, leave it there. Now if your body suffers pain and your health you can't regain and your soul
Did y'all like that? That was awesome. Amen. They do that kind of stuff where they say y'all. Amen. Praise God. Take your Bible. Turn with me to the book of 1 Kings. I heard of a gentleman and his wife who every Sunday came to church. They were hard of hearing, and the church had headphones. And so every Sunday they would come, go down to the place where the headphones were. The gentleman, because he loved his wife so much, would get a set of headphones and help his wife get them on, plug her in. And then he would get his own set and put them on and plug himself in. The pastor stepped up and said, "Today I'm going to talk about giving." And the gentleman, he said, just reached down and unplugged those two sets of headphones. And they sat there in silent bliss while the preacher talked about giving. I hope you won't turn me off today, okay? I hope you won't unplug. I'm going to talk to you today about giving. We're talking about how to make the connection in the church and how to be connected. And one of the things that God tells us we need to do as God's people is to give. So today we come to an unusual story about giving. Actually, not a story where a person gave to a church, but where a person gave to help God's messenger and God's prophet. And an incredible story today. I first learned about giving from my parents. I watched my parents for many, many years give to the Lord. They were faithful in their giving. I remember one day hearing my mother share with a neighbor, a friend of ours, and all of us kids were playing, and I don't know how I got tuned into this conversation, but the lady was talking with us. A couple of years before, my mother had to have all of her teeth taken out and dentures put in at a very young age because she had very bad teeth issues. That same year, my sister had to have two surgeries to correct an issue in her ear that was enough that it required surgery. And I remember my mom telling this friend how difficult that time was financially, but that one thing that they had learned was never to stop giving to God. And that God had always blessed, even through the most difficult, toughest times. I learned about giving, and I learned that you give from my parents. And I thank God for my Christian mom and dad who taught me at an early age by an example that they led that giving is important. Today we come to talk about this widow that Elijah went to. Now I want you to get something about this widow. She was not a Jew. She was living amongst the Jews, but she was a Gentile. And yet, when Elijah came to her and said, "God has asked you to be the one to help take care of me," this widow was more than willing to be used by God. Today, I want to talk about giving. And I want you to see six things real quickly in our story. Six things. You have an outline there in front of you. I hope you'll fill it in. Today, we're going to talk about, but first you obey. That's the title of the message. We're going to learn some things about giving from this widow. So first of all, I want you to see her opportunity. First thing is, I want you to see her opportunity. The story says that Elijah came to this woman and he said to her, "I'd like to have a drink of water," as the story progresses a little bit. And then he says in a little bit, "Oh, and by the way, bring me a piece of bread as well." We're going to find out that this woman didn't have any bread. She had just enough flour to make one little tiny cake. She was going to eat half of it, get half of it to her son. And then she said, "We're going to go and die," which literally meant we're on the edge of starvation. We're about to starve to death. But we're going to eat this last little bit, and then it won't be long, and we will die. Okay? But I want you to see something. Elijah came along, and he gave her an opportunity. Now, some think of giving as an obligation, and in a minute we're going to see that it is. But I want us to understand something. It's an opportunity. God was giving this woman an opportunity for three things. First of all, he was giving her an opportunity to meet the needs of something else. He was giving her an opportunity to be used by God to meet the needs of someone else. My friends, I want you to get something. When you give to God, you are being used by God to further the kingdom of God. I got to attend a training thing that was done by our state convention the other day. Every time you give a dollar to this church, a portion of that dollar, about 7 cents, goes to what we call the cooperative program. That money goes to the Arizona Southern Baptist Convention. Our state convention then takes that money and uses it to help reach people for Jesus Christ in our state, and then a portion of it is sent on to the Southern Baptist Convention, where it is used to send out international missionaries, some 4,000 international missionaries, to send out home missionaries, what we call now North American missionaries all across North America, to try to win people to Jesus Christ. And every year we read of hundreds, even thousands, who come to know Christ because our church gave a few pennies out of every dollar to give. You're a part of that. When you give, God is using you to help reach people for Christ. We have seen people get saved here at Grand Community Baptist Church. It's an awesome thing to find out that people are coming to know Christ. And I want to ask you something. How much is the value of a human soul? How much is the value of a person who comes to know Christ as their Savior? I want you to know it's very valuable. And when you and I give to help the ministry of this church, we help to see people come to know Christ as their Savior. And then we help to do so many other things. And we are used by God when we give. This woman was going to be used by God, but also she was going to be a blessing. She was going to bless Elijah. And then there's a third thing, and that is she was going to get blessed. You see, this woman was on the edge of starvation. We're going to find out that through the whole time of the drought, some 3.5 years, this woman would never again want for something to eat because she would give. She was going to be blessed by God. My friends, we need to understand that giving is an opportunity to be used by God. Amen? And then number two, not only do we see her opportunity, but we see her openness. We see her openness. Now, Elijah said to her, please, could I have a drink of water? And so she was going to go get something to put some water in for Elijah to have a drink of water. And then he said to her, I'm hungry. I'm hungry. Could I have a little piece of bread? Could I have something to eat? And the woman stopped. And she looked back at Elijah. And what did she say? She said, I don't have any bread. And she said, I have just enough flour and a little bit of oil in the very, very bottom, just the last little, just a little handful of flour and a little bit of bread. And I'm going to be able to mix those two and to bake one little cake, just a little small piece of bread. And then my son and I, we were going to eat that, but that's all. Many times poor people in that day lived on the edge of starvation all the time. They lived there, and she knew that within a few days they would probably starve to death. And they were hungry. And she said, listen, I don't have anything. She was open. Folks, I want us to get something. God will never come to us and ask us to do what we can't do. Amen? God will never come and ask us to do what we can't do. God knows where we are financially. God knows where you are financially. He knew where this woman was financially. By the way, do you get that God hand chose this woman to take care of Elijah? But he also hand chose this woman to be taken care of by him. He knew her story. He knew her situation. And so he said, give me something to eat. And she was open enough to tell the truth. Listen, folks, we start with God and we start with giving where we are. Now, I have to tell you, I'm talking to the choir again today. Amen. This is the givenest church I've ever met in my life. Y'all are givers, and I thank God for you. And for many of you, you're going, well, I give. And so what I want to say to you is, if you're giving, awesome. Praise God. Just be reminded that you're doing good. Amen? Amen? You're doing good. This woman was open. She just said to Elijah, listen, I don't have anything. I just have one little old hand. She was open. She was honest and open with God. But then I want you to see, third of all, her obligation. Her obligation. Elijah said something unusual to her. I want you to notice this. Said something unusual to her. Look at verse 13. What did he say to her? My translation, the New King James says, do not, what? Fear. Do you think she was worried about dying? If you think she was worried about dying, raise your hand. She was worried about dying. She says, we're right here. We're on the edge of dying. Elijah says to her, do not fear. How many times in Scripture do we hear those words? So many times. We're afraid. A few years ago, I got a phone call. You have a spot on your pancreas. I know what pancreatic cancer does. It's a killer. Was I afraid? Yes, I was. Amen. They told me the other day, we found something in your lung, in your kidney. Oh, great. You know? Was I afraid?
Yes.
Hello? Yes. It's okay to be afraid. God knows. Do you know what he said? He said, listen, she says, I'm about starved to death. Elijah said, what? Do not fear. But then notice what he says. Go and make that cake. But before you make one for you, make one for me. God says, make one for me. Bring me a cake. And then go back and make a cake for you and your son. There'll be enough. You know what he's telling her? God is about to take over this situation. And he says, you'll never run out of flour again. You'll never run out of oil again until the drought's over. God is going to take care of this. But she had an obligation. He said, you bring me the first. Church, do you know God never tells us to bring him the last part? We don't bring the remains after we've done everything else. God says, bring me the first part. Bring me the stuff first. He said, first of all, bring one to me. Bring one to me. By the way, the story says she did. Okay, we'll get to that in a sec. She had an obligation to give. She gave. She gave, okay? She knew that there was that obligation. Elijah said, give. And I promise you, God will take care of it. That comes to the fourth thing, all right? That comes to the fourth thing. That was her offer. Her offer. Elijah tells her the most incredible thing in all the world. He says to her, you're not ever going to want again. Bring one to me. You go back. There'll be enough flour for you and your son. Do you remember the story of the feeding of the 5,000? The story says that Jesus told the disciples, have everybody sit down. And they paired them up in groups of 50s and 100s. Now think about this. There was probably, counting women and children, about 25,000 people there. So now think about how many people you're trying to get all sat down and grouped up and bunched up. And the disciples said, Jesus said, now how much have we got? And they said, well, we've got, how much? Five fishes. Were they great big bass? No, they were itty bitty. How many of you like sardines? Be honest. Raise your hand. I love sardines. I can't stand. I'd rather die. Amen. Some little sardines probably are itty bitty little fish that they had cooked. And by the way, they just ate the whole thing. You know, gobbled it right down. And thought it was wonderful. Amen. And two loaves of bread. Now a loaf of bread then for that little boy was what? Biscuits, right? And the disciples would bring a basket up there, and Christ was busting those fishes and that bread. And every time he broke it, there was a lot more. I told you this the other day. I would have loved to have seen, choir, I would have loved to have seen the look on the disciples' face. That would have been one of those camera moments, you know, because he's breaking the stuff, and every time he breaks it, there's more. So the woman goes and she takes the jar and she dumps the jar out, sets the jar back down, and she makes that little cake. And then she says, well, Elijah said there'd be more, and so she looks. And there's more. She pours out the oil, makes the cake, sets it back down. In a minute, she picks it back up. There's more. Now I want to ask you, do you think there was ever more than just a little bit in the bottom? I think there was just a little in the bottom. But every time she poured it out, it came back. How did that happen? I don't know. The miracle of God. Here's the offer. In Malachi chapter 3, the scripture says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse. That's the obligation. And God says this, and test me now in this. If I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour out my blessings upon you. Here's the offer. You be faithful to God, God will be faithful to you. Listen, my friends, I have never had a supra abundance, although I have to tell you, I open my closet door and I have multiple pairs of pants. Do I need that many pairs of pants? Probably not. Right? I go open the other side, I have multiple pairs of shoes. Do I need that many pairs of shoes? Probably not. I have lots of shirts. Never wanted. You know what? The times that I was struggling to think, man, are we going to be able to make it? God always provided. Somehow. Amen? I can tell you I'm not a rich man, but I am abundantly taken care of by God. Why? Because we decided we're going to try to honor him by how we give. God said, just test me. In fact, God, would you ever say this? God is saying, I dare you. I dare you. Give and see if I won't bless you. Here's the deal. You give, he'll bless you. Now, does that mean you're going to get rich? Probably not. Does it mean that God will provide for you? Absolutely. How will God do it? I don't know. In fact, part of the adventure of life is seeing what God will do to be true to his word. Is seeing how he will take care of the needs. Amen? So we see her obligation. He said, first, bring one to me. He's seeing the offer. And if you do, God will make sure that that stuff never runs out. Okay? Then number five, we see her obedience. I love verse 15. Verse 15 says, so she went away. And it says she did what? She did according to the word of Elijah. I'm going to stop right there. She did what Elijah said. My friends, you want God to bless you, you need to do what God says. Okay? You want God to bless you, be obedient to God. Give to God. You will be stunned to see what God will do for you. You'll be stunned. She was obedient. Are you and I being obedient to God? I can tell you a lot of folks are, because our church is blessed. I have always said this, and I believe this to the bottom of my heart. When God's people will give as God commands, God's church will never do without. God's church will never do without. God's church will always have an abundance when God's people take care of the needs. reading in the Old Testament right now for a part of my daily reading, and it's awesome to see that sometimes Moses would have to say to the people of Israel, okay, you did it, stop, stop. He'd have to call them off because they were so abundantly giving that they had more than they needed. Amen? Have you ever heard a preacher say, stop giving? Not ever, have you? And by the way, you never will. You know why? Because God says as long as we're having income, we ought to be giving of that income. Amen? One last thing. Not only do we see her obedience, but the very last thing we see is her overflow. Now, notice the last part of verse 15 and then all of verse 16 and we're done. It says, and she and he, that's Elijah, and her household, her son, ate for many days. By the way, how long was that then? How long was the drought? 3.5 years. So if you do the math on that, that's over 1,000 days. And every day when she'd go in there to make bread, maybe 2 or 3 times, however often they needed to eat, there was always flour and oil. Every time, every time, every time, every time, every time. The next day, well, I wonder if we're going to be out. She knew they weren't going to be out. She'd seen it. She'd seen it. Every day. Okay? Verse 16. The bin of flour was not used up. Every time she'd pour it out empty, set it back down, when she picked it up again, there was flour in it again. The bin of flour was never used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry. Every time, pour it out and make the cakes. And then she'd set it back down, and in a little bit when she went to pour out more oil for the next time, guess what? There was always oil there. It never ran dry. Now, why did that happen? Listen, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. Listen, God was true to his word. And there was always the abundance of knowing that they were going to get to eat. A lot of people died in that drought. A lot of people literally starved to death in that drought. But Elijah and that widow and her son were adequately taken care of because this woman was willing to be used by God to give. I don't know about you. I want to be like that widow. I want to be a blessing, and I want to get blessed. Amen? Let's be like that widow and choose to obey. Pray with me. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for this incredible story, and that, God, you chose this precious widow to be used by you, dear Lord, to meet the needs of Elijah, to take care of your prophet, but then God to meet the needs of her and her son. Thank you, Lord, that you use us that way. Oh God, now I pray for this time of invitation in our church. Lord, as we invite people to give their life to you, if there are folks here that need to know you, would you help them come? Father, if there are people that need to come and become a part of this family of faith, would you speak to them, Lord, and help them to come? Dear God, I pray that you would guide and lead in these moments. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. My friends, if you're here and you've never invited Christ into your life, I didn't talk about that today, but here's what I want to say to you. Before God wants your stuff, God wants you. He wants you. He wants your life. And he sent his precious son to die for you. If you've not trusted Christ as your Savior, I invite you to come. We will share with you how to meet the Savior today and how to give your life to Him. Maybe you're here and God has spoken to you and told you that you need to become a part of Grand Community Baptist Church. Listen, this is a spectacular church, an awesome place. I am so pleased and proud to get to be the pastor here. We would love for you to come and be a part of us. We would welcome you with open arms and love you until you just couldn't stand it any longer. Amen? We'd love for you to come. If God is speaking to your heart, will you come? Maybe you need us to pray with you about something. I consider that one of the greatest privileges is to get to pray with folks when they're struggling. Could we pray with you about something? If so, please come. Stand together as we sing. If you need to come to make a commitment right now, you come.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily near.
Thank you so much. Be seated for just a moment. Now, let me remind you that we are planning a mission trip this summer, and if you feel led by God to give, you can write on your envelope, India Mission Trip, and it will go to that. Please pray and ask God how you ought to help with that. That would be an awesome thing. Again, I want to encourage you next Sunday. Please invite your friends. We have some cards out here in the Welcome Center that have the name of the church and the schedule on it, but also a map of how to get here. Take some of those, invite your friends for next week, encourage them to be here. Next Sunday, I'm going to talk about, are you sure you're saved? Do you know Christ? And how to know Christ very clearly, very specifically. Please bring your friends. It will be an opportunity for us to share Jesus with them in a non-threatening way. And then in the afternoon, we're going to gather here at 3:30. You're going to bring whatever you like to eat to watch football and whatever you like to drink. We're going to provide all the paper goods and the ice for the drinks and all that kind of stuff. So listen, if you want food and you don't bring it, then you don't get food. Amen. That's just pretty plain. Amen. You can bring sardines, but I'm not having any. Amen. Praise God. You can have some of them if you want. That'll be an awesome thing. So many other opportunities. May I encourage you, please sign up to go with us to the David Jeremiah service on March the 3rd. It is going to be awesome. You can sign up. Tickets are available. Elise Berkheimer is helping us get all that together, and I'm so grateful to her for helping us with that. We are going to be in need of some helpers in other ways with that service, and so we'll be begging in the next few weeks and asking you to help us with that. But make your plans. Make your plans to go with us on March 18th to the time when Franklin Graham will be here at the Capitol building. We're going to go and pray with Franklin Graham. And so, listen, a lot of incredible opportunities. Now, real quickly, Peggy Harvey is going to come and share with us about one of the mission things. So please listen prayerfully as Peggy comes. When Peggy is through, who is praying for us? Okay, Roger is, and Roger's at the back. So when Peggy is through, Roger, pray. Okay? So when Peggy is through, everybody stand up. Roger's going to pray. In the meantime, I'm heading toward the back, so I have a moment to take my microphone off. Amen? Praise God. Peggy, come. Here is a microphone.
14,762. Oh, my soul, it's on. Okay,
there you go. Hold it close. Talk loud.
Next Sunday is First Sunday Share. And for those of you who do not know what that is, the first Sunday of every month, we have a box in the foyer, and it's where you have an opportunity to bring things to donate. It can be clothing, it can be small household items. And so there's a big one, there'll be a big white box in the foyer. And Yvonne Sterrett takes charge of taking those items to places where they are needed, where they can bless others. Some of the places that she takes things is to Love Baptist Church, which is John Elder's church in the inner city. It's a poor church. They put stuff out on tables and people just, they just inhale that stuff. They just, to them, that is just really a big blessing, things they would not have otherwise. And so another place is Temple Schwartz and I volunteer at Eve's Treasures. It is a thrift store that benefits battered women. And when these battered women come to our shelter, a lot of them come with children. So there's a lot of needs there. That's another place where items go. They could either be, like I said, clothing or small household items. And sometimes Yvonne takes things to another little Spanish church, which is great needs. And sometimes she goes to the Salvation Army. So anyway, the next Sunday is First Sunday Share. And so from time to time, the Missions Committee will be bringing you opportunities and telling you some of the things, some of the missions that we as a church are involved in. And so don't forget next Sunday, if you don't use it, can't use it, won't use it, bring it here to First Sunday Share and bless someone else's lives. Thank you.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we are again thankful for the very freedom that we still possess as being able to walk into a church, to be able to worship and uplift your name. Our Father, we pray mostly for the blessing that you have already offered us. If we receive you to come into our hearts, that we will be a son, a child of yours, and to be able to have the promise of eternal life. Our Father, we've heard a message that represents our sheer benefit of being your child, being able to give not only monetarily, but as individuals, and give of our time, give of our service, and give of the spiritual giving to others. Our Father, we simply pray for the message we've heard, give thanks for that. We also give thanks through the message through songs, as we know that glorious is thy name. And also, if we bring our troubles to you and lay them at your feet with the confidence that you will handle whatever we walk through, we will be blessed. Our Father, we pray for those that are suffering with sickness or suffering with bereavement. We pray for the ones that were mentioned earlier. We pray for Jerry Legler as she's still having more difficulties with her disease. Pray for Ernie Lenthal and Marty as they go through this time of death of loss of Ernie's brother. Be with them and guide them and show them only the way that you can during these times of grief. Our Father, we pray now as we go through this new week that you will light our path, that we walk, and give us the wisdom and desire to better serve you and always keep you in our thoughts. These things we ask and pray in your precious name. Amen.